Welcome back, friends. We are seeing antiparkinsonian drugs. We have already seen levodopa, dopa decarboxylase inhibitors and COMT inhibitors in last video. Now in this video we will see amantadine, dopamine receptor agonists, MAO-B inhibitors and centrally acting antimuscarinic agents. So let's start with amantadine. It's primarily an antiviral drug. However, it works in parkinsonism also. It works by multiple mechanisms. It increases release of dopamine and decreases its reuptake. So more dopamine is available on cleft to stimulate postsynaptic receptors. It also has antimuscarinic effect and also blocks glutamate NMDA receptor. This effect is thought to protect from excitotoxicity. It is used alone at the early stage of disease. However, tolerance develops rapidly, so it works only for few weeks. It is also used to supplement levodopa in advanced disease to prevent fluctuation in response. Adverse effects include CNS effects like dizziness, insomnia, irritability, confusion, hallucinations and psychosis with high dose. Other adverse events are ankle edema, libido reticularis and heart failure. So this was amantadine. Next is group of dopamine receptor agonists. It has ergot derivatives like bromocriptine, pergolide and cabergoline. Non-ergot drugs are ropinirole and pramipexole. They bind directly with dopamine receptors. There are several advantages with these drugs. Their activity is not dependent on dopaminergic neurons of nigrostriatal pathway. There is less production of free radicals that is seen with dopamine. They have longer duration of action, cause less dyskinesia and have less on and off phenomenon. Now adverse events. Ergot derivatives are associated with anorexia, nausea, vomiting, vertigo, postural hypertension, peripheral edema, pleural fibrosis and erythromelalgia. Pergolide is associated with valvular heart disease. These adverse events are less frequent with non-ergot drugs. Instead, ropinirole and pramipexole are associated with uncontrollable tendency to fall asleep at any time. Adverse events due to increased dopaminergic activity are confusion, delusion, hallucination and compulsive behavior like compulsive shopping, gambling and sexual activity. They are used to supplement levodopa to smoothen on-off phenomenon. Apomorphine is used to treat off-state. Ropinirole and pramipexole are also used in restless leg syndrome. So these are dopamine agonists. Now let's see MAO-B inhibitors. I'm sure you remember that MAO-B degrades dopamine present in cytoplasm. Selegiline and rasagiline inhibit MAO-B. This prevents degradation of dopamine, so more dopamine is available to work. Also, it prevents the generation of free radicals. These drugs decrease response fluctuations. Selegiline is metabolized to amphetamine, which produces side effects like insomnia and agitation. These drugs are contraindicated with tricyclic antidepressants and selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, as there is risk of hyperthermia, agitation, delirium and coma. That finishes one more group. Now the final one, centrally acting antimuscarinic agents. Here we have trihexyphenidyl, bipyridine, procyclidine, orphenadrine, promethazine, diphenhydramine and benztropine. We have seen that apart from dopaminergic neurons, basal ganglia also have cholinergic neurons. As such, in Parkinson's disease, there is no problem with cholinergic neurons. However, degeneration of dopaminergic neurons reduces dopamine activity. This results in relative increase in cholinergic activity. These drugs block muscarinic receptors and thus bring the cholinergic activity in balance with dopamine activity. This provides some symptomatic relief to the patient. Tremors and to some extent rigidity also shows good response. However, hypokinesia respond least with these drugs. Overall efficacy of antimuscarinic drugs is lower than levodopa. They are specially indicated in drug-induced parkinsonism as they do not touch dopaminergic system. Adverse events are similar to other anticholinergic drugs like dry mouth, urine retention, constipation, blurred vision, confusion, delirium and hallucination. This completes all the antiparkinsonian drugs. Now let's see some general points regarding treatment of Parkinson's disease. As already mentioned, till date there is no drug to cure the disease. All the drugs provide only symptomatic relief and improves the quality of life for few years. Usually the drugs show good response at the beginning of therapy. However, with time, degeneration of neurons continue, so response becomes poorer as the time passes. Usually therapy is started with MAO-B inhibitors, dopamine agonists, amantadine or antimuscarinic agents. Levodopa and carbidopa are introduced later. It is usually preferred to avoid symptomatic treatment until there is some functional disability. Finally, there was a concept of drug holiday. In this, therapy is discontinued for 3 to 21 days. This is thought to restore the responsiveness to therapy and it alleviates adverse events also. However, decreased mobility during this period can cause aspiration pneumonia, venous thromboembolism and pulmonary embolism. So drug holidays are not usually preferred these days. That finally completes the entire topic of anti-Parkinsonian drugs. We are not creating fourth video of summary as of now. If you really want it, let us know in the comment section below. If these videos helped you understand anti-Parkinsonian drugs, please share them with all your friends and colleagues. And don't forget to subscribe to join us in the journey towards damn easy medical education. Thanks for watching. See you in next topic.